Frank Henenlotter. There's a story. My childhood sweetheart got in touch with me after she got divorced. And she'd been working with Frank on his early films, Slash of the Knife and so on. And so in the mid-1970s, I went to New York. I met Frank. What was very clear right from the beginning was that this was an artist and he was going to make it somehow. Whether I was involved or not, that was actually immaterial. That would be my choice. But this is a guy, he was driven and he didn't know how to stop. So he was going to have to succeed. I was at a point where I'd just been working in public administration for the last 4 or 5 years. For me to move on, I would have had to go on for a doctorate. I'd just been through school for 20 some odd years and was looking for another profession. And this was a place where here I had artists. They needed someone to be an administrator, a producer, a fundraiser. It seemed like a natural fit. The Basket Case we shot in 79, 1980. It was in post-production for quite a while. And then after it came out and started to get a bunch of interest, Frank came up with Brain Damage. And as a matter of fact, our last theatrical distributor, a fellow from New Jersey named Roger Grodd, this was a guy that was half this streetwise tough kid, and the other half was he was P.T. Barnum. And he saw the vision and he got behind us and he did the financing for the very early stages for developing the Elmer and so on. As it turned out, his fundraisers sort of left him out in the cold, and so we had to move over with Embassy Home Entertainment. And I struck up a friendship with a fellow named Al Eicher. Spot on guy, introduced us to Andre Blay. We got artists that loved Basket Case, such as Gabe and Al Maglicetti. And so they were sending resumes and samples of their work to Frank. And that's kind of how it came together.
I was working for a makeup artist, Arnold Gargiulo, and he took me under his wing and allowed me to work at his studio. First for free as an intern, then getting paid to clean buckets, and then to go on set with him. And it was an amazing experience because at a very young age, I was getting very hands-on experience. And it was that leap from playing with Dermawax and paper mache and things I could only get a hold of around the household to working with him. It really blew the doors open for what makeup effects contained, all the more modern materials. He had finished The Deadly Spawn, which was a high-profile project for him, and then he had met Edgar Evans. Arnold had gotten the job for a film called Spookies, and Spookies had a lot of creature effects in it, and the whole production was a wonderful bunch of people. It was definitely like a family. I lived on set. We were building stuff there in Westchester. So, but then Arnold had a conflict of interest, creative differences with the production. And he stepped away. I was already deeply involved and got along with the producers and the directors. And they said, well, yeah, we're fine if Gabe takes over. But Arnold and I still remained friends and professional. And at that point, he began talking with Edgar Evans and Frank. And I remember clearly one day going back to my room where I was sleeping at this carriage house on the property of Spookies. And there was a note on my door left by a secretary. Frank Henenlotter called. And I was like, whoa, cool. What happened was the discussions that Frank was saying, Arnold was just like, what? Like some parasitical eel and people, you know, shriveling from withdrawal. And it was not a turn on for Arnold. While every sentence I heard, I was getting higher and higher as a kite. I'm like, oh my God, this is all in one film? And we had a meeting where I was tagging along with Arnold. And amazingly, after that meeting, Frank had told me, he said to Edgar, he said, we're not going to work with Arnold, but I'm interested in his assistant. And Edgar said, that like 19-year-old kid? And Frank said, yeah, that's the spirit we need for this.
The way I met Frank was through an article in Fangoria. They'd done an article on Basket Case and about how it was heavily censored, and I felt bad about that. I don't like, you know, seeing anybody's work censored like that. So I wound up looking his number up. He was in the phone book at the time. And I called him up and I just figured, you know, say a little words of support or whatever. He wound up picking up the phone. We had a very long conversation and it led to a lot more conversations. He originally brought me in on a film he was planning on doing called Insect City, which involved big giant cockroaches. And I wound up sculpting a cockroach about 2.5-3 feet long, which it wound up never getting used, but that led directly to brain damage. I was working on another film called Spookies. Frank gave me a script called Elmer the Parasite. I was working with Gabe Bartalis on Spookies, and I read the script on the way back to the set, and it was just off the wall, crazy. And I knew Gabe loves this kind of stuff. So the minute I got back to the set for Spookies, I handed it to Gabe and said, whatever you're doing, stop. Read this now. You're working with me on this.
At some point, they had a script they were comfortable with that maybe the production had said this is going to be the shooting script. And Frank distributed it to the department heads. Frank writes excellently. They're very formal scripts, but since he's a writer and director, he's got that cool talent that the written word very gracefully translates to how it'll be shot. So you get a very good understanding of what he's going to expect. And script was loaded with stuff. It had what could have been elements that would satisfy any other build list for a film. It had this singing, talking, animatronic eel creature that had many different builds to sell it as one creature that could do a lot. There were many gore effects, makeup effects that are wildly fun to do. And there were the disintegrating makeups on Martha and Morris as their withdrawal syndrome set in. So all of this under one umbrella, one picture, brain damage, was super exciting to me as an effects artist.
Frank is a professor of English literature. So he has the wealth of all English literature to draw upon. Essentially, we're retelling the story of Faust. Okay, that you can have eternal wisdom, youth, vitality for a price. Okay, so we're retelling an age-old story. We're telling it in a new way. I think that's what gives it legs, is that it's really based in legitimate literature.
With a lot of the stuff, you're kind of making it up as you go. You basically have to say, we have this much money, which isn't much. This is what Frank needs to see. How do we get there?
Developing Elmer, it was funny. Frank was really specific, and I could see him trying to come up with the words to say it.
I seem to recall him saying he wanted Elmer to look like a black dildo because it was the most offensive thing he could think of.
There was talk of phallus, of a turd, of a hilarious cartoon that of the mouth just like this. He loved the cartoon aspect of doll-like eyes. It's so interesting because when I saw the final film and I saw the fully mean scene of Rick in the hotel going through his withdrawal, it was all the more demented because of how comical Elmer was and playful. And, you know, that dichotomy, I think, you know, Frank as the director has an overview of stuff. And I thought, wow, this is really demented that he pushed for these cartoon aspects because he knew he'd be slamming them against these very serious themes of withdrawal. And you've now spent the film loving this actor and sympathizing with him. And now he's in a sweaty, vomiting mess pleading for a hit, you know? All the more bizarre because of this wacky character. Frank would be there in pre-production time, always in the offices they were planning, building the sets. He always set aside time to come to sit with me. And we would look, and while I was sculpting him, his input, he was right there over my shoulder. So very quickly, he'd be like, yeah, I love that texture. Do that veiny stuff. Hey, suction cups. Let's do suction cups. Okay. No, funnier on the eyes, funnier on the mouth. You know, I want it like, arr. Once there were certain landmarks there, I was able to do what I do and flesh it out. And it went rather quickly. It was exciting that once these landmarks of the detail, of the cartoon aspects, of the phallus-like shape And very specific that a brain head, that it should be this knobby brain top just to, you know, play into the title, to play into what he feeds off of. Those various elements all spoke to one another and gave me enough information to push forward. And so as I would present the rough sculpture, very quickly we got both excited about it. There were two primary sculptures. There was the actual size Elmer, and then for the close-ups, there was a big oversized one. And I love sculpting. It's one of my favorite things to do in the makeup effects creature process. And when you get lost in those details, it's fun because sculpting is really you and your art against the clay. Something like Elmer, you know, being encrusted with those veins and lines, you know, there's no beating around the bush how phallic he looks. And that was encouraged. So, you know, I think there may even be hints in the sculpture itself of maybe male reproductive organs. I kind of added some nuance to in there on top of the head to subliminally keep reinforcing that point. Like, yeah, what you think this looks like, it kind of is, and it's even made up a little of it.
Hi. John Zacherle was the original host of Chiller Theater. We're talking early 1960s.
I'm an East Coast guy, so I grew up watching Zach on TV, and I was thrilled to hear that he was doing the voice of Elmer.
From now on, your life will take on a whole new light, and all you have to do is look into the light and listen. Listen to the light, Brian.
It was exciting when Frank told me in hushed terms that Zacherle is going to be the voice.
What a nice room, Brian. This is a real classy place.
He also told us that Keep It Mum, this is a non-union film. He's willing to do it because it sounds fun. And they're just going to simply not credit it. He did come around to set twice, so we got to meet him. I was aware of him, and Frank just loved him.
He was wearing, as I recall, like a white cowboy suit complete with 10-gallon hat. That was the only time I ever saw Zacherle.
Seeing Zacherle's voice coming out of Elmer was also perfect. And this is where, again, Frank was doing his job as a director. He saw the entire picture. While he was guiding me to do the design, he also knew this voice is going to be coming out of him. And again, how demented it'll be when he's singing a playful tune while someone's suffering in front of him.
So wingers! Well, the old way and then the old time, the hurdy-gurdy.
In our film career, there are a number of people that we met who were luminaries, who were stars, in our eyes anyway. And it was just such a joy that they were so much more gracious than we could have ever imagined. Well, clearly, the special effects that these kids brought in were tremendous. What they did was they took a lump of rubber and gave it life and made it believable.
For this crew, I had Jim McLaughlin making molds. I had Rich Mayone running foam rubber and fabrication. Dave Kinlan was doing animatronics, mechanics. Benoit Laston, a friend of ours from France, came and joined us. And Nikki Santarama doing fiberglass.
From the first couple of minutes, as you look at one of Frank's films, you might be distracted by the lack of production value because we didn't have any money. But within about 4 minutes, 5 minutes tops, all of a sudden, Frank would get you because the story would be so overwhelming and so compelling. And making that story come through, this is something where the combination of Dave and Gabe, they gave this little lump of rubber personality. They gave it life. They gave it believability, credibility. And people were, like, interacting with it throughout the film. It, just amazing to see.
In 1982, I moved to New York City to study filmmaking at the School of Visual Arts. And the dorm for SVA was Sloan House, a YMCA on 34th Street and 9th Avenue, which was a very scuzzy, delightful neighborhood at that time. One of my housemates in this dorm and one of my classmates was Jimmy Muro, who of course went on to direct Street Trash, and he's directed television episodes like Longmire. Jimmy came into SVA and he was a superstar from day one because as a teenager, he had been a production assistant on Frank Henenlotter's first feature, Basket Case. And Basket Case was enjoying its midnight run right during that period. So I think it ran at the Waverly Twin for 2 years, and it was a regular event for people in our dorm to go check out this film. So we were pretty much in the thick of the Frank Henenlotter boom when it began. I didn't meet Frank during my college tenure, which lasted all of 1 year, but after SVA, another classmate, Peter Clark, and I both had jobs at a video store in Times Square. And it was basically while working at that store that I met Frank. And Frank regularly came into the store to buy copies of Basket Case for friends, relatives, whoever. He didn't want to take advantage of the sales discount that the distributor probably offered him. He said to me one day, this thing needs all the help it can get. So he would come to the store frequently to buy copies of his own film, but also to order other titles through the store owners. So he was a regular. And Peter Clark got to become friends with him before I did. Peter and I went on to make Slime City before we worked on Brain Damage. There was a 9-month period where we shot Slime City, immediately jumped onto a film called Plutonium Baby, and then segued into Brain Damage. And we brought with us a lot of the crew people from Slime City. Ed Walliga from our crew became the production manager, and Joe Warda, our sound engineer, became their assistant sound person, and Brett Petrocelli, our second AC, became their second AC, and Ivy Rozovsky, our costume person, became the costume person and art director on Brain Damage, and Dan Fry, who was straight makeup and assistant effects on Slime City, became the straight makeup artist on Elmer the Parasite.
Oh, I love the script. Frank has a very sort of interesting, flamboyant way of writing scripts, so it's actually fun to read, very descriptive. So I looked at by the end of the script, I thought, oh, this is a movie I want to watch. Well, I was hired to be key makeup artist. It's that sort of classic thing that there's very few people doing a lot of different jobs on the film. But I also worked with Gabe Bartolis, who was doing the prosthetics in the sort of lead-up stages of Brian's kind of withdrawal. So he had kind of set a design for other characters, and because I had done prosthetics, sort of very sort of basic ones, I kind of knew how to talk to him about sort of the designs of these makeups, really.
So there were 7 people from Slime City on this film, in addition to quite a few people from Basket Case and quite a few people from Street Trash. So there were really crews from 3 different fairly seminal New York sleaze movies all working together. And that led to a lot of friendly competition and a lot of jokes. As I recall, the Basket Case people kind of dropped like flies. I mean, Frank, of course, stayed on, and Edgar and Bruce, who was the DP, and Jim Muro was doing Steadicam. But other than them, the veterans of Basket Case only lasted a week or so, external problems and whatnot.
I have what's known as anti-talent when it comes to casting. I will really exert my best effort, my best choices, exercise my best judgment. And when it gets down to like between 2 or 3 choices for a role, Frank would come up with me and go, you know, we're looking at these guys and, you know, maybe we could give your opinion, you know. And I would give them my best opinion, and they'd walk out of the room and they'd be laughing hilariously because whoever I picked was the wrong person. And I mean, it's like I didn't have anything against these kids. And of course, I would find out later on that Frank had made the exact correct choice. But several films in a row, they did that to me. And damn it, they got me every time with that. It was just like here I was getting an opportunity to participate in the artistic end. And it was like when Charlie Brown wants to kick the football and Lucy takes it away. I mean, in all good fun, but I have anti-talent. So the characters were as much a surprise to me as eventually they were to the audience.
I'm the guy who will sit in a horror film and jump and yell and scream like in Times Square. So getting involved in this, I mean, it was so exciting for me because it was my first job ever, straight out of, you know, conservatory. I was studying there in New York. You know, I was classically trained actor. You know, it was either Shakespeare and then this came. So it was Shakespeare in to a certain extent, because the elements that you have to deal with in a horror film are so extraordinary that you have to give way to it completely and totally. So it was a real exercise in suspending your own disbelief, especially when you have about 8 to 10 inch long turd that's, you know, inhabiting the back of your neck most of the time. I don't remember a lot about the audition process. I just remember once I got the role, I started doing my research into, you know, when I thought of brain damage, I was a big Pink Floyd fan. So immediately I was like trying to delve into the lyrics of that song and, you know, how it correlated with this. And I was very much locked into my music for this role. Clearly I wasn't a drug addict. I mean, we did drugs at that time, you know, but it was, again, the Reagan years. But I really kind of decided that I had to go into my own world and figure out what that feeling was like, that journey you had to take, and that it wasn't something that was negative. It was all this sort of like positive escapism that, you know, I think we were all kind of locked into at that time. The funniest choice that I think Frank made for me as a character, I was a young kid. I wasn't rough looking, you know, and I think he wanted sort of some kind of edge to me in some way that would, like a chink in the armor, why Elmer could get to him. Otherwise, he's like, this is this nice kid. He just happens to live with his brother and whatnot, and he has a nice girlfriend, and like, why is he the host? Why would he be the perfect host? Well, he is the most innocent, and that's the one who's most easily manipulated. But Frank wanted, if you'll notice, I have a cut on my lip in the movie, the entire film. Just because he felt like I needed to have that as part of the character, otherwise I looked too pretty. And I was like, that did it? I mean, you could have scarred me here. I mean, I could have had part of an ear off. I had that later on. I mean, it just could have been anything. But that was the oddest choice about it. He said, just give him a scar. I was like a cold sore? He's like, no, like a cut.
Rick put in tons of hours, put in, long hours. I kind of covered him with makeup. He was cold, and then he was hot, and then he was tired, and then he wasn't, you know. So I kind of really had a lot of time for him, and he was an absolute lovely, lovely fella.
The cast that a special makeup effects artist inherits is very interesting. And on Brain Damage, I was very lucky because Rick Herbst is perfect, because he's definitely the handsome straight guy. He fulfills that in spades as to what you want to see the minute you see him. Yet, getting to know him during the shoot, he's incredibly flexible and giving, to where these ludicrous things that we were gluing on him, from suction cups in a dream sequence to, again, these very cartoon lumps in the head that are swelling. Every actor will sit because he's told to, but to own it and transmit that to the screen as good as Rick did, I think we got very lucky with him.
I want a couple of screaming.
I personally, as a means of trying to be able to get in character, I slept on the set of my room pretty consistently. And they just laughed at me. They thought, what are you doing? This is ridiculous. And I'm like, no, guys, you got to understand this. I have to have some kind of connection with it in order for it to be believable. The other thing that was really new to me was prosthetics in general. The prosthetics were tough to deal with, because if you're claustrophobic, which I am a little bit, that's the first time I had all the plaster on me, and they had to take a full cast of it, because they had to make several different models of my face, which was pretty bizarre. And I remember that Gabe and Dave like talking to me during the whole thing and messing with me the whole time. Gabe Bartolos, just as an aside, Gabe Bartolos was, first of all, he's a brilliant effects artist. Just an absolute master. Gabe was the most imposing freaking figure. I mean, This is a guy who, you know, I was frightened of, you know, but because he was just so off. That whole makeup crew was just this sort of band of, I don't even say misfits, they were borderline, like, these are the guys you don't want to meet in the street, you know? But they're also like 8-year-olds with putty. Literally, it was like going from watching monster movies to like playing with the models to this. And it was like the greatest playground. So I really learned to, in my fear of Gabe, appreciate their artistry. And I think that was really where my connection came to identifying what the relationship between Brian and Elmer would be, because they had that. And that's where I really drew it from, because there's no way you can just go, let me see, what in my past or what can I assimilate in terms of friendships that I've had in my life would equate to a talking dildo? I don't know. Nothing. So I really kind of relied on them.
It was a Frank film. There were bucketfuls of weird stuff, and he's not getting away from it. Rick is the star.
My image of Frank was him sitting in his office, which was part of the entire floor on 33rd Street in this like warehouse building that was, quite frankly, I think we were the only inhabitants of.
I found a building in Manhattan where our equipment rental house was on the first floor. The second floor we rented out as living space for Gabe and Dave Kindlin to stay in when they came in from Rochester. And then we filmed on the fourth floor. So we didn't have to deal with Teamsters, which was incredible to film in New York City. But because we had nothing on wheels, we had no traveling, there was no way they could interfere.
You wanna run through now?
All right, let's do it.
Action. Okay. All right. Now we gotta hold first. We don't dolly in on action.
Is that gonna smear, Frank?
So don't even do it. You can go like this, but can you see me?
One of the ironies was that we shot in a studio on 33rd Street between 9th Avenue and 10th Avenue, so we're about half a block away from Sloan House, where Jimmy and Peter and I had all stayed. While we were going to SVA. And I remember when we would walk into the warehouse that we converted into our sound studio, one of the games we would play every day would be to count how many used condoms were on the sidewalk, because there were so many hookers in that area at the time.
I would, you know, show up there in the mornings, and literally I would be stepping over crack vials and used condoms, and occasionally people who use the crack vials and unused condoms.
There were four floors in that building. The first floor was a camera rental house. It was Mike Spira's rental house, who we rented our equipment from. And Mike Spira had been the assistant camera person on the Lords of Flatbush. And unfortunately, he was still building his facility while we were shooting. So we were, I think our soundstage was on the third floor or the fourth floor. Our system was to have extension cords running out the window and down three or four floors, and we would pop an extension cord into the wall and a light would go off down there in the basement, and Mike Spira would know to stop jackhammering or whatever construction noise was going on at the time. He was cooperative but not entirely pleased with us. So the work that we did to get this place ready was we laid down a soundproof floor, we built walls, basically created a space that sets could be built on. And as I recall, we had a large space, which we used for the courtyard, and then a smaller space, which we used for the different apartment sets. And then off to the side was a separate small studio space, which Al Maclachetti, it's where he did his stop motion animation.
I was primarily hired for the animation and what at the time was called optical effects. I would shoot certain things in layers, and then through a process of optical compositing, layer them all together and print two or three pieces of film onto one to get some weird psychedelic effect. I was the only one shooting any of the animation. I wound up taking that footage to a gentleman in Los Angeles, Pete Curran, of a place called VCE, Visual Concept Engineering. I'd worked with him previously, and he had the equipment and wherewithal to pull it all together with his staff. He had put in some time at Industrial Light and Magic as an animation supervisor there. I think at the time he was doing Beetlejuice, and RoboCop were all going on at the same time through his shop. I crossed over into the physical effects every now and then. It was primarily Gabe Bartalis and Dave Kinlan doing the Elmer effects, but there were little things like, for example, I wound up doing the foaming at the mouth gag on Morris and Martha at the beginning of the film. It essentially was like an Alka-Seltzer, Bromo-Seltzer type of thing where we just put it in their mouths and let them foam. We did a test. It actually looked kind of funny. We did a test, shot it on video, and showed it to Frank, and he okayed it. We get on set to do this trick, and in this particular shot, the camera was mounted on top of the set, kind of precariously, looking straight down at them, because Frank wanted to do this lonely zoom back of these two people as they're going through withdrawal. So Gabe and I set the actors up with the seltzer, and you had to take a drink of water to get the stuff going. Set them in position. Frank rolled the camera. We gave him the stuff. They hit the position and immediately started foaming at the mouth. And I moved off set. I'm trying to be very quiet so I don't blow the take. And I feel on my shoulder this meaty hook grabbing me. And it was Gabe, who is biting his own fist, going like, as he's trying not to laugh hysterically, which of course gets me laughing hysterically. And I wound up biting on my own fist, and we're basically punching each other off camera, quietly trying to shut each other up so we don't blow this take as these two elderly people are foaming at the mouth in front of us, and Frank is on top of the set wall looking down at the camera because we don't want to do this again. They were really long days. We got very punchy at some points. And it got to the point where sometimes we didn't even know what we were doing.
We worked 16-hour days, 6 days a week. We worked 100-hour weeks. So first of all, yeah, we were a lot younger back then. That's a young person's challenge.
The construction of a partial area of set, that was eye-opening to me. It's like, it was almost harder for me to imagine where I was when they gave me a physical representation of like the corner of a hallway. Like, here we go, here's two flats, and that's the corner of your hallway. I can't see it. Yet, I'll imagine it in class, and it's like, it never worked that way.
Rick Hurst was totally into this. He was like one of the guys.
Oh. Oh.
No matter what we threw at him, he was up for it. There was a scene I had to do where brain matter starts gushing out of the side of his head after he pulls his ear off in a hallucination. In order to get the kind of velocity we wanted to out of that ear, I built the set kind of on an angle. So there was a metal brace there that he fit into while he was on a 45-degree angle. And we shot that as a split screen. We shot him screaming, then got him out of there, and Gabe and I hooked up this gigantic piece of heat ducting to the earpiece that was on the metal brace. I got up on top of the set with a gigantic spaghetti pot full of gore and just dumped it down this tube. And because it was on an angle and we had the camera on a matching angle, it looked like it had a little more velocity and it went flying out a lot further than it would have if we had him just sitting up normally.
Well, we built this really authentic SCSI set, but for the exterior, Frank had spotted a hotel in the Bowery, the Sunshine Hotel, which he wanted to get the rights to film in. Joe Orta, the assistant sound person, and I were dispatched to the Bowery to secure permission to film for an hour or two at the Sunshine Hotel, which I would be very surprised if it's still there. And so we went down to the hotel, and somehow through the instincts of private eyes, we were able to determine that a pawn shop setup is where the people who ran the hotel were based. So we went into this place, and there's scuba diving equipment on the walls and just weird stuff everywhere, and there was no one in the store, and a guy came in and said, "Hey, are you Frankie?" "No, I'm not Frankie." "How about you? Are you Frankie?" "No, I'm not Frankie." "Well, somebody told me I could sell scuba gear to Frankie." So, "Well, you'll have to come back. I'm sorry we're not here." Eventually, Frankie came in, and he directed us to a real estate office across the street. At least I remember it being a real estate office. So we went into this real estate office, and the largest Doberman Pinscher I've ever seen was stretched out across the floor. I thought it was a horse. And behind the counter was a big, muscular man, I believe of Italian persuasion. I believe he also had a shoulder holster. And the back of this store was sort of elevated, so you had to go up a few steps to get up there. And sitting behind a desk was about a 300-pound version of Vincent Gardenia, who was sitting here like this, just watching us. And the big muscular guy behind the counter asks us if he can help us. We explain we want to use the hotel as a location. He looks at the Vincent Gardenia guy. We look at the Vincent Gardenia guy. Vincent Gardenia goes. So we have to tiptoe around the Doberman Pinscher. We have to present ourselves at this railing, looking up to this gentleman. Explain to him what we want. Maybe we can pay $100, maybe $200. He says, all right. For $200, you can shoot at the hotel for 1 hour. But if you go over that 1 hour, it will cost you $200 for each additional hour. Okay, sure, fine, whatever you say. Got the hell out of there. Needless to say, we shot the footage in an hour and we got out. So I told this gentleman that in addition to paying him this exorbitant amount of money, this high fee, for use of their location, that the film would be happy to give the Ray Barry family credit in the film. Ray Barry, besides owning a pizzeria one time, is the family-owned business that places pizza ovens in pizzerias all over Manhattan and Brooklyn. And he said, no! The Ray Barry name must not appear in this film. And so it didn't, until now.
If you're filming in New York City, and if you're filming in the dark corners and in sort of the lights out in the dark places, you can make New York City one of the characters and one of the leads. You can feature it, and all of a sudden, you use your weakness as a strength. And you don't try to make it look glamorous. You really get the blood and guts out there, and you just embrace what you have. Oh my goodness, for brain damage, we had absolutely no permits for anything, with the exception of Frank wanted to do a scene on the New York subway.
So the train sequence, I don't know if it's still set up this way, but in New York City, there's a special train that they let movies shoot on. And it runs 90 minutes into Brooklyn, and then it reverses and comes 90 minutes back into Manhattan. So they could afford to rent this train for 3 hours.
Filming in the New York subway is impossible, and the insurance that you have to take out to cover the transit authority is just monumental. It's just astronomical. So Frank comes up with this idea of, if we have to pay this money and we actually have to rent the New York subway, let's get the most out of it.
But we had 3 hours to shoot that whole sequence where Brian kills his girlfriend. And that's also the scene where Kevin Van Hentenrick, of course, makes his cameo as Dwayne Bradley from Basket Case. And that's kind of an interesting story because everyone was excited that Kevin was coming. And it was very difficult to find a basket to match the one of Basket Case. So that entailed a whole search. And then Kevin showed up and he had shaved his hair into a crew cut. And you couldn't even tell it was the guy from Basket Case. And Frank threw his arms up. It's like, oh, we shouldn't even bother then. But it was decided that he could wear a wig and it worked out fine.
And I remember that the other passengers on the train, once we were on the train, they were just all excited because they were looking, they saw Kevin Van Hentenrick, and everyone said, oh, look, there's Eddie Van Halen. And so, of course, I assured them that that's exactly who it was because that's what my job was at that time. So,
I think we were filming outside. I think there's a scene where Brian comes into the club and you see a sort of bum, like a down and out, and he's kind of on the stairs and he's just sort of crying. We had no place to sort of set up the food, you know, lunch or dinner. So it was kind of around a corner. And I remember seeing our actor, our tramp, and then us seeing two other tramps. basically filling up a plate of food, and they, you know, smelled bad, you know, really bad. And so it's quite sort of funny. I have a very sort of thin line between the crew and people that came and watched.
Here's the funny thing. I completely forgot about this. My wife was actually in the movie. My now wife. And there's three girls waiting to get into the bathroom. And the blonde with the biggest and the poofiest hair was my then girlfriend, now wife, who Gabe Bartolos always used to tell me that he was going to steal away, especially during that particular day. He shaved his head. All the guys, that was another thing that was incredible. Dave and Gabe literally shaved their heads into mohawks, as if Gabe wasn't imposing looking enough. There's a scene actually where I'm dancing opposite him and I'm just all high and freaking out. I'm like looking at his collar and playing with it and everything, and he's just like bumping up against me.
I'll tell you, the post-production, we really benefited by a certain time and space. Okay, back in the 1980s, there was a building in New York City, the Film Center building, and the building had editing facilities for picture, sound editing, sound transfer facilities, and they regularly and very graciously would let folks like us, low-budget people and essentially people with no money, go in after hours, and as long as we cleaned the space by 8 a.m. when the paying customers arrived, we had access to literally the entire building, or different floors on the entire building.
I think I met Frank, I think it was like when he was doing Basket Case. This was like 81 or something. I was working out of this other place called Phantasmagoria. It was like a post-production place. And I think one day he showed up with his film. I think he was working, doing the sound part of it out of this place. And then I got to know him and his producer, Edgar. And I think I invested some money in Basket Case, and that's how I got to know them.
Jimmy Quay, yes. Jim was an editor who was an assistant editor for Martin Scorsese, and he worked at nights in the Film Center building.
He's a nice guy. I mean, he's easy to work with. I mean, he was very specific in terms of where the cuts were going to be. I don't know if he storyboarded stuff. I'm sure he did, but he must have had a good idea of what he wanted to shoot and how to put it together exactly. I mean, I remember he had this handwritten list that he gave me a copy of in terms of like every shot and where he was going to go. I do remember, you know, thinking back on it, I do remember that, I don't know if I can say this, but the first cut ended up to be like 66 minutes long, and it's a feature film, so I guess he made it move so quickly that it was too quick. And then I just told him we have to slow it down, and I think we put, let's say, front and end pieces back in, you know, just to bring it up to length. And if you watch the film, you'll see that it's fine, and that it's the right pacing and timing, you know. But I think maybe when we were sitting there, we just wanted to have everything move quickly, and we did it too fast, you know.
Frank was very giving that when scenes were assembled, we would look at them. The editorial was happening there in the production offices in a side room. And I think it was a way of Frank of checking himself, make sure the scenes are playing. And the fact that everything was being shot locally and in this building, there was a good safety net. Hey, we missed it. I should do a close-up of a hand on a doorknob. You just pick it up the next day. You know, we're in the same setups. So we saw a lot of the sequences, and a lot of times Frank was just being generous, like, check out this kill. It's amazing, you know? And it might be shot in pieces over a week, and here it is put together playing as one bit. There is a scene where Rick meets a young lady at a punk club, and they go off for an intimate moment and she gets ready to go down on him, and Elmer surprises her, goes into her mouth, and I mean, even on set, it was graphic. And the scene crescendos with another Elmer I did on a pole rod where we actually put real calf brains into Vicky's mouth. And the brains being so organic, nothing would stick to it. Super glue wouldn't stick, no adhesive. So about half hour before the sequence, I sewed through the membranes of the brain into the mouth of Elmer and could cinch it so that as I held Elmer, there was about a 6-inch strand of brain hanging off of it. That was positioned on the rod at groin level. When we were ready to roll, we gave Vicky blasts of Banaka and we packed in the brains. It was as graphic as it is now. We were just like, whoa. She gets a beer tonight.
It was released by Paramount Pictures. Oh, my goodness.
The theatrical and home video were cut, and Frank knew that was going to happen. There was actually scenes written in the script, in particular the Night Watchman scene, where Frank wanted to tint it, and quoting from the script, it said, "which should really confuse the MPAA when they try to rate this."
For me, selfishly, I wanted it in there. I built it. We spent time and money on it. And it tells the whole arc of the scene. You know, there's a beginning, middle, and an end. And a lot of these parts they removed are the punchline. You could be messing with the gag, the rhythm of the storytelling. So it's nice that we got him back in there.
I was in Los Angeles at the time, and I found out that they were showing it. It's kind of funny when you're first starting out in the business, you don't know where your work is going to land. You know, who's going to liken to it, and you know what kind of niche it's going to fall into and whatnot. I didn't know. You know, for all I thought, I was going to be in the vein of like doing it like a Carpenter film. And I was like, yeah, man, this is like I'm going to. And I went to the. And it's sort of sad now to think back to, but understandably, I went to the Egyptian Theater to see it, and myself and my family and a few friends. We're the only people in the actually movie theater. And I had friends of mine that were laughing, but not in the right way, when they saw the actual thing. And I was embarrassed to this, only to the point that I couldn't appreciate it for what it was. Because I was looking at it as it was gonna have a lot more mainstream. Appeal. And the hysterical thing is I didn't realize the impact or the widespread popularity that it came to have as a cult film until later in my career. And then again, like I laughed because my own sons came to me and were like, do you know how many of my friends like are freaked out that you're Brian? And I'm like, yet I've done all these other roles in television and had Emmys and stuff like that. It's like, that's what they recognized me for. And it really was nice because, and especially now that the re-release of the film is there, it makes you kind of realize that no matter what you do as an actor, it's going, if you give 150% towards it, it's gonna find its audience. And it makes me feel good that it did find a place and people do appreciate it. And when I go back and look at it now, I can understand and appreciate it actually for what it's worth and the messages that it was supposed to come across and why. You know, it's what we're putting out is entertainment. And it's really, you can make people think, you can make people laugh, you can make people smile, you can make people pissed off, whatever. If you're evoking a reaction in some way and people are invested in it, you did your job. And that's ultimately what I took away from the whole thing.
I would say it was not a tremendous box office hit, but it had legs. And it has been popular year after year. For someone else who's interested in making a low-budget film, my strongest suggestion would be that you need to understand that low-budget films cannot be made by committee. You have to have a vision. You have to be singularly committed. You have to be behind that vision. You have to shut out all those well-intentioned interlopers that just have the best intentions but no idea what's going on, And they may have a little bit of film experience, so they, let's say that it's all coming from a good place, that they want to help out, but they're getting in the way. You have to pick your horse, you have to back that horse, and you have to run with it, and you have to make that happen. You have to have that singular commitment in order to make a low-budget film work. And I've seen just a tremendous cross-section of people who identify with Frank's films, who identify with the amount of work that went into it, and those were very, very special times.
I think the horror films I worked on were more, I don't know, I think they were trying to make a buck. But I think Frank's stuff, it was about something else. It was about this guy wanting to make these films because he wanted to, not because if I make Basket Case, I'll get rich and can go to Hollywood. I think he made that so then he can make Brain Damage.
Frank is stupendously modest. You know, I saw Basket Case, his first film, loved it, worked on Brain Damage, his next film, and actually worked on Frankenhooker and Basket Case 2. And he really does take chunks out of all these movies. And he certainly takes chunks out of Brain Damage, and he doesn't... He kind of points out all the mistakes and things like that. And I kind of think they really do hold up. Some movies really kind of, you know, kind of last, where we can kind of go back to them and they kind of stand up, you know, even though they're very made on, you know, $1.50, you can kind of still enjoy them. And I think I was, it's quite a sort of pleasure to work on it. And I do sort of meet lots of people that just come out of nowhere and go, you worked on Brain Damage. And these are people that have worked on huge movies, but they really kind of like the fact that it was made for nothing, you know, and a lot of work was put into it. So.
Nobody looked at this film as something that was, you know, just kind of like a stopping point on the road in their career. So, I mean, I will forever look back on this particular film with a point of pride, you know. And to say to myself, you know what, had I not done Brain Damage, I probably wouldn't have had, you know, the career that I had going forward, because it taught me that all work is good work and that every role is as real as you make it.
I have been in the culinary world now for a number of years, and my background in making horror films, particularly Brain Damage, has had very little effect, as I've proved. But we do have a little ice cream brain here, and I want to show you that it's anatomically correct, that we have all the proper colors, and that at the very center is deep, dark chocolate, the same way as everyone's brain is fixated. So, this is a little example of my new art form and what I do these days.